Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Wounded Storyteller, Body, Illness, and Ethics, Second Edition, by Arthur Frank. Narrated by Trevor Thompson. Publisher's Note: In this audio edition, you will hear references to visual elements present in the print and ebook formats of the book. I had grasped well that there are situations in life where our body is our entire self and our fate. I was in my body and nothing else. My body was my calamity. My body was my physical and metaphysical dignity. Jean Amaury. Preface, 2013. I wrote the outline of The Wounded Storyteller in early spring 1994, while I still had stitches from the biopsy that determined I was not having a recurrence of cancer. Enlarged lymph nodes on my lungs and diaphragm had caused the suspicion of recurrence. To everyone's great relief, these were attributed to another disease, sarcoidosis, which I had not heard of. I never could take sarcoidosis seriously. All that mattered was not having cancer again. Writing The Wounded Storyteller was as much a work of self-healing as of scholarship. I needed to gather around me voices that shared what I had been through during the previous years of illness. I had written about my own experiences in a memoir, At the Will of the Body, but I needed the insights and articulations of other ill people to assure myself I wasn't crazy. I needed others' thoughts in order to become fully aware of my own. That is the book's consistent message about why suffering needs stories. To tell one's own story, a person needs others' stories. We were all, I realized, wounded storytellers. The wounded storyteller is anyone who has suffered and lived to tell the tale. Suffering does not magically disappear when the tale is told. But the more stories I heard, the less space my own suffering seemed to take up. I felt less alone. This book was my attempt to widen the circle, to amplify and connect the voices that were telling tales about illness, so that all of us could feel less alone. The Wounded Storyteller is a guide and a companion, a truth teller and a trickster. She or he is a fragile human body and a witness to what endures. People need a guidebook for the day when they become wounded storytellers, because most people find themselves unprepared. I certainly needed such a book, despite having spent much of my professional life studying healthcare. The Wounded Storyteller was my attempt to provide that guidebook. In this edition, I have not attempted to revise the text. Only this preface and the afterword are new. What surprises me rereading the book is how little my ideas about bodies, illness, and ethics have changed. Since I wrote this book, I have read new memoirs of illness and interviewed ill people. But as generous as those people were about their experiences, the voices here are the ones that continue to resonate in my thinking, defining illness for me. The voices that speak to us at particular moments in our lives, especially during transitions or crises, imprint themselves with a force that later voices never quite displace. Returning to The Wounded Storyteller, I realize how deeply I love the voices of those whose stories I retell. Both people I actually knew, and writers whom I came to feel I knew. This book was written at two particular moments. In my life, I was at the end of a decade when it seemed all my conversations ended up being about illness, and most started that way. The book was also written at a particular public moment when ill people were claiming the right to tell their own stories, but that right had yet to be attained. Today, illness stories proliferate, especially on the internet and in mass media. But when I was gathering the materials for this book, speaking publicly of illness felt new and necessary. When my mother had a mastectomy in 1964, and my task was to tell some of her friends what had happened. I had difficulty speaking the words. Almost 25 years later, when I joined a cancer support group sponsored by a national organization, we were not allowed to post flyers in the local cancer center to tell patients where and when meetings were being held. My sense of what was deeply wrong was affirmed when I read Audre Lorde, who wrote as a breast cancer survivor around 1980. My silence had not protected me. Your silence will not protect you. That quotation is one of the lines that resounds loudest when I think about illness. My questions are always, who is preserving what silences? What do they imagine is being protected by silence? And who suffers by being kept silent? Lorde shows a way out of silence, speech that has the power to create community. But for every real word spoken, for every attempt I had ever made to speak those truths for which I am still seeking, I had made contact with other women while we examined the words to fit a world in which we all believed, bridging our differences. The Wounded Storyteller was written to expand that contact between people who had stories to tell of illness. I sought to examine the words in which people attempted to speak the truth about illness, words in which they tried to fit a world that seemed worth believing in. This book is not a memoir, as deeply rooted in my own experience as it is. I wrote it with a sociologist's core conviction that people's sense of their own originality is highly overrated. The book reflects a tension between two recognitions of human life that sound paradoxical, but are actually complementary. First, people's experiences are intensely personal. Claims to the uniqueness of experience are true and deserve to be honored. Second, people's ability to have experiences depends on shared cultural resources that provide words, meanings, and the boundaries that segment the flow of time into episodes. Experiences are very much our own, but we don't make up these experiences by ourselves. People tell their own stories about illness, but what seems worth telling, how to format the story, and how others make sense of the story, all depend on shared ways of narrating illness. The core chapters of The Wounded Storyteller describe three narratives that storytellers and listeners use to structure and interpret stories, respectively: restitution, chaos, and quest. Each is also a way of experiencing illness. I developed my descriptions of these three narratives by sifting through my memories of conversations and notes from memoirs. But in retrospect, each narrative also expresses a moment in my own illness experience. Restitution represents my life as a patient. Healthcare workers expected any experience to be interpreted within a narrative of movement toward recovery of health. Whatever happened to me could be understood only as a necessary step toward that achievable goal of health. I wanted to get well, and appreciated reassurance that I would. But I also needed recognition of my suffering at that particular moment, as well as recognition that my recovery was by no means assured. I increasingly resisted the restitution narrative, especially how it positioned the physician as the protagonist and relegated me to being the object of that protagonist's heroism. I was certainly part of this story, but it could never truly be my story. The restitution narrative had no space for the chaos element of my illness. The months when my rapidly progressing testicular cancer was misdiagnosed, first as a sports injury, muscle strain, and then as an unknown disease, probably, but not certainly, cancer. Chaos was in the disconnection between the increasing pain that was sending my life off the rails and my physician's frustrated insistence that nothing serious was wrong. Chaos was in the claustrophobia of confronting others' inability to see what I so clearly felt. Many people with chronic illness, especially multiple sclerosis, have written about this diagnostic uncertainty and the relief when some physician validates how much is actually wrong, as devastating as that diagnostic news can be. My own chaos was bad enough, but I never experienced the chaos in which many people feel trapped, when each misfortune seems to trigger some other collapse. Disease leads to job loss, which creates a housing crisis, and then some other family member gets sick. However, I went through enough to recognize that desperation and the silence that chaos imposes. Those living in chaos are least able to tell a story, because they lack any sense of a viable future. Life is reduced to a series of present tense assaults. If a narrative involves temporal progression, chaos is anti-narrative. My period of chemotherapy was bordering on chaos when my understanding of what I was going through began to shift. A sequence of experiences brought me out of an obsession with my own pain and vulnerability, and gave me a sense that I was participating in something shared. Time spent being ill ceased to be time taken away from my life. Instead, how I lived with illness became the measure of how well I could craft a life, whether I was ill or healthy. This attitude is the basis of understanding one's story as a quest narrative. Illness remains a nightmare in many ways, but it also becomes a possibility, especially for a more intimate level of connection with others. Illness's quest is described by Anatole Broyard's posthumous collection of writings, Intoxicated by My Illness, which became available late in my work on The Wounded Storyteller. Broyard, a writer of some fiction and much literary criticism, presents living with rapidly progressing prostate cancer as a problem of style. It seems to me that every seriously ill person needs to develop a style for his illness. I understand telling stories as an especially important medium through which we discover what that style might be. Storytelling is less a work of reporting and more a process of discovery. Broyard then writes the sentence that, in retrospect, defines not only the quest narrative, but the core issue of The Wounded Storyteller. It may not be dying we fear so much, but the diminished self. He thus expresses what remains my crucial question. If I become ill again, or when I do, how will I find ways to avoid feeling that my life is diminished by illness and eventually by dying? Broyard was clear that physicians were often a part of the problem of diminished lives. Doctors discourage our stories, he writes. I did not include that dig at doctors and The Wounded Storyteller, and I am surprised how disciplined I was in depicting healthcare professionals only from the perspective of patients and minimizing even that. My intent was to write a book that kept healthcare workers generally, and physicians specifically, in the background. Even criticizing doctors makes them central. On rare occasions when I have taught this book, students' biggest initial difficulty is to stop reframing everything ill people say into a question of how some healthcare worker might respond. This reframing can be important later for other audiences. But taking the professional perspective undoes what The Wounded Storyteller is most concerned to bring about, a view from the ill person's perspective, in which the central problem is how to avoid living a life that is diminished, whether by the disease itself or by others' responses to it. The professionals in healthcare and other fields who have communicated with me about The Wounded Storyteller all realize that providing treatment should not be equated to offering care, however that distinction is expressed in the respective idioms of different professions. Others are working to make sense of their own suffering, struggling to find words and narratives that share their experiences with others. What I appreciate most is when the boundaries between these two types blur. Professionals bring their personal suffering into their work, and ill people discover forms of vocation in illness. The Wounded Storyteller, ending silences, speaking truths, creating communities, becomes the wounded healer. Calgary, Alberta. Preface. The figure of the wounded storyteller is ancient. Tiresias, the seer who reveals to Oedipus the true story of whose son he is, has been blinded by the gods. His wound gives him his narrative power. The wound that the biblical patriarch Jacob suffers to his hip while wrestling with the angel is part of the story he tells of that event, and it is the price of his story. As Jacob tells his story to those he returns to, and who else could have told it, his wound is evidence of his story's truth. This book presents ill people as wounded storytellers. I hope to shift the dominant cultural conception of illness away from passivity, the ill person as victim of disease, and then recipient of care, toward activity. The ill person who turns illness into story transforms fate into experience. The disease that sets the body apart from others becomes, in the story, the common bond of suffering that joins bodies in their shared vulnerability. The emphasis of contemporary writing is less on the wounded storyteller than on the complementary figure of the wounded healer. For example, Henry Nouwen's The Wounded Healer bases the spiritual vocation on the minister's acceptance and sharing of her own woundedness. Physicians from Arthur Kleinman to Larry Dossey and journalists like Bill Moyers present the wounded healer as an ideal for medical workers. Rita Sharon writes of the physician's need to allow our own injuries to increase the potency of our care of patients, to allow our personal experiences to strengthen the empathic bond with others who suffer. Sharon can be read equally well as describing the ill person's need. As wounded, people may be cared for, but as storytellers, they care for others. The ill, and all those who suffer, can also be healers. Their injuries become the source of the potency of their stories. Through their stories, the ill create empathetic bonds between themselves and their listeners. These bonds expand as the stories are retold. Those who listened then tell others, and the circle of shared experience widens. Because stories can heal, the wounded healer and wounded storyteller are not separate, but are different aspects of the same figure. But telling does not come easy, and neither does listening. Seriously ill people are wounded not just in body but in voice. They need to become storytellers in order to recover the voices that illness and its treatment often take away. The voice speaks the mind and expresses the spirit, but it is also a physical organ of the body. The mystery of illness stories is their expression of the body. In the silences between words, the tissues speak. This book is about hearing the body and the ill person's speech. The chapters that follow begin with how illness requires stories. The body is the ground of these stories, and illness stories is what are called self-stories. The middle chapters describe three narrative types of illness stories, understanding these narratives as ways of using the body. These middle chapters suggest what illness stories tell. The final chapters move to the force of that telling. They locate the ethical imperative of illness stories in issues of testimony and witness. In wounded storytelling, the physical act becomes the ethical act. Kierkegaard wrote of the ethical person as editor of his life. To tell one's life is to assume responsibility for that life. This responsibility expands. In stories, the teller not only recovers her voice, she becomes a witness to the conditions that rob others of their voices. When any person recovers his voice, many people begin to speak through that story. Stories of people trying to sort out who they are figure prominently on the landscape of postmodern times. Those who have been objects of others' reports are now telling their own stories. As they do, they define the ethic of our times, an ethic of voice, affording each a right to speak her own truth in her own words. This book is a work of theory, but it is equally a collection of stories and a kind of memoir. For almost a decade, I have been a wounded storyteller, and I have cultivated the stories of others who are wounded, each in different ways. the theory in this book, elaborates my story and theirs. Charles Lemert introduces his social theory textbook by calling theory a basic survival skill. The Wounded Storyteller is a survival kit, put together out of my need to make sense of my own survival, as I watch others seeking to make sense of theirs. The Wounded Storyteller, like Lemert's theorist, is trying to survive and help others survive in a world that does not immediately make sense. Sooner or later, everyone is a wounded storyteller. In postmodern times, that identity is our promise and responsibility, our calamity and dignity. The theory I propose here is one toolkit to help fulfill that promise and exercise that responsibility. 20 years ago, when I was a graduate student, theories were proposed with the tagline that they awaited further research. I now prefer the idea that this theory awaits further living and the stories of those lives. The theory has been shaped by the stories I have been privileged to live and to hear, and I encourage the audience to reshape it in the same spirit. 1. When bodies need voices. The destination and map I had used to navigate before were no longer useful. These words were in a letter describing chronic fatigue syndrome. Judith Zaruches wrote of how, after an illness that is never really finished, she needed to think differently and construct new perceptions of my relationship to the world. Serious illness is a loss of the destination and map that had previously guided the ill person's life. Ill people have to learn to think differently. They learn by hearing themselves tell their stories, absorbing others' reactions, and experiencing their stories being shared. Judith's story not only stated her need for a new map and destination, her letter itself was an experimental performance of the different thinking she called for. Through the story she was telling me, her new map was already taking shape. Even though we did not know each other, Judith needed to write to me. She had read my own story of cancer and seen a videotape of a lecture I gave, for me to witness her story and her personal change. As she told me her story, she discovered new perceptions of her relationship to the world. That my response would only come later, in another letter, perhaps made it easier. Seeing herself write, like hearing herself speak, was the major threshold. Judith's distinctiveness as a storyteller is her illness. Illness was not just the topic of her story. It was the condition of her telling that story. Her story was not just about illness. The story was told through a wounded body. The stories that ill people tell come out of their bodies. The body sets in motion the need for new stories when its disease disrupts the old stories. The body, whether still diseased or recovered, is simultaneously cause, topic, and instrument of whatever new stories are told. These embodied stories have two sides, one personal and the other social. The personal issue of telling stories about illness is to give voice to the body, so that the changed body can become once again familiar in these stories. But as the language of the story seeks to make the body familiar, the body eludes language. To paraphrase Martin Buber, the body does not use speech, yet begets it. The ill body is certainly not mute. It speaks eloquently in pains and symptoms, but it is inarticulate. We must speak for the body, and such speech is quickly frustrated. Speech presents itself as being about the body rather than of it. The body is often alienated, literally made strange, as it is told in stories that are instigated by a need to make it familiar. The alternative to this frustration is to reduce the body to being the mere topic of the story, and thus to deny the story's primary condition. The teller has, or has had, a disease. That the teller's diseased body shapes the illness story should be self-evident. Only a caricature Cartesianism would imagine a head, compartmentalized away from the disease, talking about the sick body beneath it. The head is tied to that body through pathways that science is only beginning to comprehend, But the general principle is clear. The mind does not rest above the body, but is diffused throughout it. That actually hearing traces of the body in the story is not easy. Observing what stories say about the body is a familiar sort of listening. Describing stories as told through the body requires another level of attention. This book attempts to evoke this other level of attention. How can we make sense of illness stories as being told through the diseased body? The ill body's articulation in stories is a personal task, but the stories told by the ill are also social. The obvious social aspect of stories is that they are told to someone, whether that other person is immediately present or not. Even messages in a bottle imply a potential reader. The less evident social aspects of stories is that people do not make up their stories by themselves. The shape of the telling is molded by all the rhetorical expectations that the storyteller has been internalizing ever since he first heard some relative describe an illness, or she saw her first television commercial for a non-prescription remedy, or was instructed to tell the doctor what hurts, and had to figure out what counted as the story that the doctor wanted to hear. From their families and friends, from the popular culture that surrounds them, and from the stories of other ill people, storytellers have learned formal structures of narrative, conventional metaphors and imagery, and standards of what is and is not appropriate to tell. Whenever a new story is told, these rhetorical expectations are reintroduced in some ways, changed in others, and passed on to affect others' stories. A first topic of this book is the need of ill people to tell their stories, in order to construct new maps and new perceptions of their relationships to the world. A second topic is the embodiment of these stories, how they are told not just about the body, but through it. A third topic is the times that stories are told in, how the social context affects which stories get told and how they are told. The central issue of context is the distinction between illness as experienced in modern versus postmodern times. Postmodern illness. The prefix post is not quite right. I do not propose any strict periodization of the modern and the postmodern. I do believe that over a period of time, perhaps the last 20 years, how people think about themselves and their worlds has changed enough to deserve a label. And the most accepted label, increasingly diffused in journalism and popular culture, is postmodernism. Because of the number of intellectual agendae that employ some version of this label, I prefer postmodern times. The times that contemporary illness stories are told in, which are also the times I am writing in, have changed fairly recently. Albert Borgman's title, Crossing the Postmodern Divide, provides a particularly useful metaphor. Journeys cross divides. Once on the other side, the traveler remains the same person, carrying the same baggage. But on the other side of certain divides, the traveler senses a new identity. That same baggage now seems useful for new purposes. Fundamental assumptions that give life its particular meaning have changed. Postmodernity is such a crossing, occurring when the same ideas and actions are overlaid with different meanings. Sometimes these differences of having crossed the divide are clear, but more often they are subtle. Things just feel different. Illness has come to feel different during the last 20 years, and today the sum of those differences can be labeled postmodernism. I make no attempt to define postmodernism. The utility of that term lies only in thick descriptions of the feel of the differences. A useful, if simplified, evocation of the shift from the pre-modern experience of illness to modernity is provided by a North African woman quoted by Pierre Bourdieu in his anthropological research. That Bourdieu recorded this quotation from a living person is a reminder of the proximity and overlap of the pre-modern, modern, and postmodern. In the old days, the woman said, folk didn't know what illness was. They went to bed and they died. It's only nowadays that we've learned words like liver, lung, stomach, and I don't know what. Of course, pre-modern people had rich descriptors for disease and its remedies. Ethnomedicine was and is highly specific. But I interpret the speaker's closing exclamation as indicating being overwhelmed. She literally doesn't know what. The specialized medical terms that the woman claims her people have only recently learned overwhelm her experience because they come from elsewhere. The shift to modernity crosses a divide into a medical culture that is foreign to this woman's experience of illness. The modern experience of illness begins when popular experience is overtaken by technical expertise, including complex organizations of treatment. Folk no longer go to bed and die, cared for by family members and neighbors who have a talent for healing. Folk now go to paid professionals who reinterpret their pains as symptoms, using a specialized language that is unfamiliar and overwhelming. As patients, these folk accumulate entries on medical charts, which in most instances they are neither able nor allowed to read. The chart becomes the official story of the illness. Other stories proliferate. Ill people tell family and friends versions of what the doctor said, and these others reply by telling experiences that seem to be similar. Both experiences they have had themselves, and ones heard from others. Illness becomes a circulation of stories, professional and lay, but not all stories are equal. The story of illness that trumps all others in the modern period is the medical narrative. The story told by the physician becomes the one against which others are ultimately judged true or false, useful or not. I will discuss Talcott Parsons' theory of the sick role in later chapters. What is relevant here is Parsons' observation, made about 1950, that a core social expectation of being sick is surrendering oneself to the care of a physician. I understand this obligation of seeking medical care as a narrative surrender, and mark it as the central moment in modernist illness experience. The ill person not only agrees to follow physical regimens that are prescribed, she also agrees, tacitly, but with no less implication, to tell her story in medical terms. How are you now requires that personal feeling be contextualized within a secondhand medical report. The physician becomes the spokesperson for the disease, and the ill person's stories come to depend heavily on repetition of what the physician has said. Times have come full circle from Bourdieu's North American informant when we read of a patient whose running joke with his surgeon involves reporting his symptoms in an overdone version of medical obscurity. For example, if you will diligently investigate the pilar projections rising sparsely from the vertex of my cranial ossification, you will detect a macular callosity which may have malignant potential. If modern medicine began when physicians asserted their authority as scientists by imposing specialized language on their patients' experiences, the postmodern divide is crossed when patients such as this one can mimic this language in a send-up of medicine that is shared with the physician. But lay familiarity with medical terms and techniques, even to the point of parody, is only one potential of the postmodern experience of illness. The postmodern experience of illness begins when ill people recognize that more is involved in their experiences than the medical story can tell. The loss of a life's map and destination are not medical symptoms, at least until some psychiatric threshold is reached. The scope of modernist medicine, defined in practices ranging from medical school curricula to billing categories, does not include helping patients learn to think differently about their post-illness worlds and construct new relationships to those worlds. Yet people like Judith Zeruch's express a self-conscious need to think differently. Both the divide that was crossed from the pre-modern to the modern, and that from modern to post-modern, involve issues of voice. The woman reported by Bourdieu seems to perceive that medicine has taken away her voice. Medicine assails her with words she does not want to know and leaves her not knowing what. but this woman does not perceive a need for what would now be called her own voice, a personal voice telling what illness has imposed on her, and seeking to define for herself a new place in the world. What is distinct in postmodern times is people feeling a need for a voice they can recognize as their own. This sense of need for a personal voice depends on the availability of the means, the rhetorical tools and cultural legitimacy for expressing this voice. Postmodern times are when the capacity for telling one's own story is reclaimed. Modernist medicine hardly goes away. The postmodern claim to one's own voice is halting, self-doubting, and often inarticulate. But such claims have enough currency for illness to take on a different feel. Voices tell stories. Stories are pre-modern. Bourdieu's informant suggests that the coming of modern medicine took away a capacity for experiencing illness in her folks' traditional stories. In the modern period, the medical story has pride of place. Other stories become, as non-medical healers are called, alternative, meaning secondary. The postmodern divide is crossed when people's own stories are no longer told as secondary, but have their own primary importance. Illness elicits more than fitting the body into traditional community expectations or surrendering the body to professional medicine, though both community traditions and professional medicine remain. Postmodern illness is an experience, a reflection on body, self, and the destination that life's map leads to. The Remission Society. The possibility, even the necessity, of ill people telling their own stories has been set in place by the same modernist medicine that cannot contain these stories. At the end of the story that I wrote about my own experience of having cancer, I used the term remission society to describe all those people who, like me, were effectively well but could never be considered cured. These people are all around, though often invisible. A man standing behind me in an airport security check announces that he has a pacemaker. Suddenly his invisible condition becomes an issue. Once past the metal detector, his remission status disappears into the background. Members of the Remission Society include those who have had almost any cancer, those living in cardiac recovery programs, diabetics, those whose allergies and environmental sensitivities require dietary and other self-monitoring, those with prostheses and mechanical body regulators, the chronically ill, the disabled, those recovering from abuses and addictions, and for all these people, the families that share the worries and daily triumph of staying well. Kathy Pierce writes in middle age about having a bleeding cerebral aneurysm, a stroke, when she was 20. During the operation, a cranial nerve was damaged. She still suffers from double vision, which she reports is an ever-present reminder of her near-death experience. Her body is now beginning to feel the long-term effects of muscle asymmetry and favoring her good side. But her illness history would be invisible to most people she meets, and she is long considered cured by medicine. Kathy is a member of the Remission Society. Years after her hospitalization and treatment, she can still describe what happened in exquisite detail. She recalls the hurt caused by a nurse's casual comment, as if it had been spoken yesterday. She refers to being a recovered stroke patient as one aspect of her ethnicity, a word suggesting an irrevocable identity. The physical existence of the Remission Society is modern. The technical achievements of modernist medicine make these lives possible. But people's self-consciousness of what it means to live in the wake of illness is postmodern. In modernist thought, people are well or sick. Sickness and wellness shift definitively as to which is foreground and which is background at any given moment. In the Remission Society, the foreground and background of sickness and health constantly shade into each other. Instead of a static picture on the page where light is separated from dark, the image is like a computer graphic where one shape is constantly in process of becoming the other. Parsons' modernist sick role carries the expectation that ill people get well, cease to be patients, and return to their normal obligations. In the remission society, people return, but obligations are never again what used to be normal. Susan Sontag's metaphor of illness as travel is more subtle than Parsons' sick role. "We are each citizens of two kingdoms," Sontag writes, "the kingdom of the well and that of the sick. Although we all prefer to use only the good passport, sooner or later each of us is obliged, at least for a spell, to identify ourselves as citizens of that other place." Sontag's notion of dual citizenship suggests a separation of these two kingdoms. The remission society is left to be either a demilitarized zone in between them, or else it is a secret society within the realm of the healthy. To adapt Sontag's metaphor, members of the remission society do not use one passport or the other. Instead, they are on permanent visa status, that visa requiring periodic renewal. The triumph of modern medicine is to allow increasing numbers of people who would have been dead to enjoy this visa status, living in the world of the healthy, even if always subject to expulsion. The problem for these people is that modernist medicine lacked a story appropriate to the experience it was setting in place. People like Judith Zaruches were left needing a new map for their lives. The postmodernity of the remission society is more than a self-consciousness that has not been routinely available to the ill. Many members of the remission society feel a need to claim their visa status in an active voice. Those who work to express this voice are not only postmodern, but more specifically, post-colonial in their construction of self. Just as political and economic colonialism took over geographic areas, modernist medicine claimed the body of its patient as its territory, at least for the duration of the treatment. "When we're admitted to a hospital, or even visiting a doctor," writes Dan Gottlieb, who as a quadriplegic has extensive experience with such visits, "the forms ask for patient name. We stop being people and start being patients. Our identity as people and the world we once knew both are relinquished. We become their patients and we live in their hospital." Gottlieb's anger reflects a widespread resentment against medical colonization. For those whose diseases are cured, more or less quickly and permanently, medical colonization is a temporary indignity. This colonization becomes an issue in the remission society when some level of treatment extends over the rest of a person's life, whether as periodic checkups or as memories. The least form of treatment, periodic checkups, are not just monitoring. "The fear comes and goes," writes Elizabeth Tyson, a breast cancer survivor. "But twice a year, at checkup time, it's ferocious." For the person being checked, these checkups represent the background of illness shading back into the foreground. Even for those whose visa is stamped expeditiously, the reality of lacking permanent citizenship is reaffirmed. Colonization was central to the achievement of modernist medicine. Claudine Herzlich and Jeanine Perret describe the sick person emerging as a recognizable social type in the early modern period, during the 18th century. The condition necessary for the emergence of this type was that the diversity of suffering be reduced by a unifying general view, which is precisely that of clinical medicine. This reducing of the particular to the general provided for scientific achievements, but the clinical reduction created a benevolent form of colonialism. The ill person who plays out Parsons' sick role accepts having the particularity of his individual suffering reduced to medicine's general view. Modernity did not question this reduction, because its benefits were immediate and its cost was not yet apparent. The colonization of experience was judged worth the cure, or the attempted cure. But illnesses have shifted from the acute to the chronic, and self-awareness has shifted. The post-colonial ill person, living with illness for the long term, wants her own suffering recognized in its individual particularity. Reclaiming is the relevant postmodern phrase. In postmodern times, more and more people, with varying degrees of articulation and action, express suspicion of medicine's reduction of their suffering to its general unifying view. Members of the Remission Society, who know medicine from the inside out, question their place in medical narratives. What they question can be clarified by drawing an analogy to people who were politically colonized. Gayatri Chakravarti Spivak speaks of colonized people's efforts to see how the master texts need us in their construction, without acknowledging that need. What do the master texts of medicine need but not acknowledge? I met a man who had cancer of the mouth that required extensive reconstructive surgery to his jaw and face. His treatment had been sufficiently extraordinary for his surgeon to have published a medical journal article about it, complete with pictures showing the stages of the reconstructive process. When he told me about the article and offered to show it to me, I imagined the article might actually be about him, his suffering through this mutilating, if life-saving, ordeal. As I looked at the article, I realized his name was not mentioned. Probably the surgeon in the journal would have considered it unethical to name him, even though pictures of the man were shown. Thus, in his article, he was systematically ignored as anyone, actually anything other than a body. But for medical purposes, it was not his article at all. It was his surgeon's article. This is exactly the colonization that Spivak speaks of. The master text of the medical journal article needs the suffering person, but the individuality of that suffering cannot be acknowledged. Most ill people remain willing to continue to play the medical patient game by modernist rules without question, and almost all do so when required. But post-colonial members of the Remission Society are demanding, in various and often frustrated ways, that medicine recognize its need for them, refusing to be reduced to clinical material in the construction of the medical text. They are claiming voices. Because illness, following medicine, is effectively privatized, this demand for voice rarely achieves a collective force. Feminist health activists are a major exception. Susan Bell writes about the attempts by members of the Cambridge Women's Community Health Center, WCHC, to change the role played by women who were recruited by Harvard Medical School to serve as paid pelvic models for medical students to learn to perform gynecological examinations. Bell tells of the women's escalating demands to participate in a full teaching role, rather than serve as inert bodies to be taught upon. Women negotiated for their own class time with medical students. They sought to demonstrate how women could perform their own gynecological examinations using a mirror, and they injected political issues into the medical curriculum. The medical school finally rejected WCHC demands that teaching be limited to women, since the experience of being examined should be, in principle, reciprocal. That non-student hospital personnel and other consumers be included in the teaching sessions, and that more political discussion contextualize the medical teaching. The specifics of the WCHC demands are less important than their basic post-colonial stance. Women wanted to have their necessity acknowledged in the construction of medical knowledge and practice. They claimed an active voice in that knowledge and practice. Postcolonialism, in its most generalized form, is the demand to speak rather than be spoken for, and to represent oneself rather than being represented or, in the worst cases, rather than being effaced entirely. But in postmodern times, pressures on clinical practice, including the costs of physicians' time, and ever greater uses of technology, mean less time for patients to speak. People then speak elsewhere. The post-colonial impulse is acted out less in the clinic than in stories that members of the Remission Society tell each other about their illnesses. The post-colonial stance of these stories resides not in the content of what they say about medicine. Rather, The new feel of these stories begins in how often medicine and physicians do not enter the stories. Postmodern illness stories are told so that people can place themselves outside the unifying.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.